Hold the right there. Благодаря на всички, че дойдохте на това събитие с нашия лектор Виктор на българската Java User група, Cosmos Local Technology. Най-важното нещо, погледнете се и там отзад, там е бирата, ще има пица малко по-късно. И колко по-високо от микрофона? Елате по-наблизо, има още две места на първия ред. Ето, готово. So the agenda for tonight, there is a 1 hour of lecture by Victor. Then there is a short break where we are going to vote for a few minutes. There will be going to be a form on that you can vote on about what are going to be the live coding session for the next 30 minutes. So it's 1 hour talk, then voting part, which you vote and you can go to the toilet. So there is a short break, and then there is 30 minutes of live coding. Is that right? Yeah. Okay, so let me introduce Victor.
Thank you for having me here, first of all. Well, today I'm wired. I never had a microphone with a wire before, but this is the best quality that you can get. Can you hear me, all of you? No? Is it louder this way? Perfect, okay. So, evolving a clean, pragmatic architecture, that's the topic. But before we start with the real content, let's us discuss a bit about some day-to-day pains that we experience. Now, if something is painful and you cannot avoid doing it, what does a human do?
Quit.
Skip it. Leave it for tomorrow, right? Postpone. And then tomorrow, well, what happens? Tomorrow you become a lead. No. Tomorrow, if you're a lead, you will delegate it, of course. So this is not very mature, right? What you should do instead is to do it more often. If it hurts doing push-ups, do more push-ups, right? If it annoys you, cleaning up your room, clean it more often. Bring the pain forward. That's the philosophy behind extreme programming. Who of you have ever heard of extreme programming? Raise your hand. Extreme, excellent. This doesn't mean, more than half, doesn't mean to be paragliding while coding, no.
It means to be a professional. I could scream if you want, but
Coming back to our pains, how does it feel when you are running or you are working on your own branch for 2 months? The inevitable will follow, right? So what do they say? What do extreme programmers say? Okay, don't wait for the inevitable, but do pushes. Push as often as possible. Do continuous integration. Do pushes at the end of the day, if not more often. I have a colleague. Which pushes every 15 minutes. If you don't push with her, you are left the fool of the village. You know, you are. She does dozens of commits per day. Continuous integration. If you are strong enough, try trunk-based development, feature toggles. Why? Because any long-lived feature branch will inhibit refactoring both on the branch, and on the trunk. So you need to be short. You need to go for short-lived branches. Then. After you submit your pull request, what will happen? They will call you for a code review. Tell me, how do you go for a code review? Humble, for sure. So what do they say? Don't wait for the inevitable, but instead do pair programming. Ask for help. Step on your pride and ask for help when something is just 1% above your skills. When you are feeling uncomfortable, have courage and admit it and ask for help, right? Don't be ashamed of that and ask for a senior to assist you. 7 minutes can save you days of work, really. Then, how does it feel when you're running some code which was never refactored? Never refactored. Never. So what do they say? Don't wait for the sprint refactoring. Instead, do continuous refactoring. Any diff, any pull request you submit should be worthy of being added to your CV. Exactly. This is how you should feel, okay? Don't just limit yourself to putting your if there, where you should. But do more kind of things around you. Continuous integration. Then the last, but the most dreadful fear of all. How does it feel when you run into some code with exactly zero automated tests? Zero automated tests. This is like life, huh? This is like,
yeah.
This is what real men do, right? It's horrible. You won't dare to touch anything, because if you touch it and you break it, then it becomes yours. You know that, right? Of course. What? Enterprise product developer, yes. So what do they say instead? Do tests first. Maybe you can't do tests first for that feature, but for the least minimum, when you submit your pull request, tests should be there next to your implementation code. Always submit production code together with tests. Good. All of these fears are addressed by extreme programming. But tell me, are you agile? Yes. Agile-ish, right? Agile-ish.
My boss says
yes. But do you know, agile in its original form didn't meant a gazelle. They didn't thought of a gazelle when they said agile. Because, you know, what? When business looks at us, they often see dinner. This is not agile, my friends. This is, unfortunately, agile of Eastern Europe. I'm sorry to say that. But they keep throwing at us features, of course, with a fixed deadline. And if you consult the dictionary, Webster Merriam, the first definition of a deadline is the line around the prison that if you cross, you will get shot. No, real stuff, get shot. The second one is has to do with time, right? So, shot, not shot, but shot. Yeah? So, deadline, thank you for deadline means that's not agile. Agile at the beginning meant some of the practices. Those who struggle today to resuscitate those technical practices gather under the umbrella of software craftsmanship. And if you can read here, it says, Bucharest Software Craftsmanship Community, 1,023 members. So I'm serious about this stuff. Doing emphasis, emphasizing again the technical practices. When's the last time you reflected on how you work? Well, when the last time you deliberately did some practice of your own, just to increase your skills, right? We don't have a code of ethics. Uncle Bob keeps talking about this, right? We need to have the oath of Hippocrates for programmers. We won't ever submit code without tests. We won't ever submit code which is not well factored. I swear, you know? We don't ever do that, right? Software craftsmanship means to put back the focus on the technical practices, right? All right, in this happy tone, I am Victor Enta, the second Java champion of Romania. I am currently also working at IBM as an internal consultant. That's what the fireman stands for. You can get the picture? When something is wrong, where is Victor? No? That's not. I'm also this software craftsman, and this is basically a statement. I do pair programming every freaking minute. I do refactor. I never wrote code wrong for the past 11 months. 11 months, never. I always, when I wrote code in production, I write with someone next to me. Maybe two of them, maybe even three of them sometimes. Doesn't matter, depending on the complexity. Refactoring every minute. NTDD every week. Once every 5 days, in average, I studied myself. I can delineate the problem and quack it with TDD. It's not all the everyday TDD, but if you can do tests first, do it. Now, I've been talking quite a lot. I found this community. Unfortunately, until now, on this community, I only speak in Romanian because I want to get to their souls. It's deep. Clean code, refactoring, TDD is mostly a motivational speech. And you can't possibly get to someone's soul unless you talk their language. So stop saying code smell. Translate it to Bulgarian. How is it in Bulgarian, code smell?
Code smell.
I hope it sounded bad enough, right? So, that's okay. I've been talking quite a lot. The point of this slide, however, is that I have a website. That's the moral of the slide. In this website, you can find me, all my best talks. If you listen carefully to all my talks that I gave, you can find more than half of my training material there. Technically, what I do, or actually, I do trainings. But every now and then, I summarize a part of the most interesting part of various trainings in a talk. and I have quite good rated talks. Now, the point is, I've been training quite a lot speaking. This means 12 months of continuous speaking, 8 hours per day in front of the developer. This is insane, my friends. And to have a work-life balance back home, I keep quiet. Okay, my topics are Spring, Hibernate. Most of you, I'm sure, I never find better audiences than in meetups. I will keep saying that forever. At conferences, some people are pushed, let's go there. Who the heck takes from family time, from personal time, to come and listen after work to an insane guy speaking some more stuff? Come on. So you are among the best developers in Sofia, I'm pretty sure. So, no, really, I'm really, that's why I do this community meetup. Yes. Now, all of you, I'm pretty sure half of you at least, can do an internal workshop on these topics. These are immediate frameworks, learn, teach, very easy, right? Design patterns, the architecture, okay. Then Clinker, unit testing, performance, Sky. Even yesterday I had my O'Reilly live training. You know the platform, Learning O'Reilly? I'm there with the big guys. Okay, so I do this every now and then. But the point of this slide is in the corner, of course. I post like a maniac a lot of stuff on these three social networks, all of them. Stuff that I showed you in the beginning, this funny stuff, plus more deep stuff, really. I started posting on social networks to answer one single question. How do I convince my boss to give me time for refactoring? That's currently the driving point. How do I convince? Okay. So, what's the most important principle in programming? In three letters. OCP. Now, another most important principle. Now. Geez, I love it. I love it. Simplicity, but not, that's not the...
Dry
is a principle derived from pain. You see code which is pretty much the same and you need to find the differences. Do you remember kindergarten? Circle the differences. And after doing this for several months, years, kind of decades, you say, dry, don't ever repeat yourself, I will catch you. No, not dry. What else is there in three letters? Come on. TDD is a methodology, technically speaking, is a way of thinking, not TDD. But technically, all the computer science books that talk about design start with one thing. SLP. Nice. Think responsibility, a function should do one thing and one thing only. A class doing persistence of an employee, generation of payroll, PDF report, what the heck? How many lines does this class have? 1 too much, huh? 1,000 too much. So we should split it nicely into smaller classes, one doing one single thing, SLP. Hand in hand with SLP comes with cohesion, that's the concept. They are highly cohesive classes. No, they have highly cohesive design. Don't try that, it doesn't work. So, hand in hand with cohesion comes coupling. Coupling means the degrees of coupling between the classes of your system. This is our system, the spaghetti code. This is the better loosely coupled design. Now, historically they said these are easier to change in the right part because less classes will get impacted. Right. But tell me, how do you edit your code? In Vim?
Emacs.
The rest of you? IDEA. Okay. So we need to shift and fix. That's why IDEA developers walk like this on the streets. Have you ever wondered why? So if you rename anything Shift F6, then it will be automatically renamed everywhere. What the heck, right? So renaming is not a problem anymore. You would use the IDE, of course. But what is still a problem is how do you test that thing?
You just don't.
Exactly. Whereas here, we could mock these other things, or is it easier to test if it's a loosely coupled design? So technically speaking, loosely coupled means more testable, which is good. Then, dry, of course. Dry. It hurt us, so it must be here. Right. Don't ever repeat yourself. But we are allowed to copy from Stack Overflow. There is a book on this topic. However, don't ever copy paste your own bugs. And do you know the Anthony, right? We enjoy typing. Write everything twice. Right. Now, but my favorite, of course, is keep it simple. And the whole point of this talk is just that. Keep the architecture simple, for Christ's sake. Keep it simple. Because if you overdo it, if you over engineer it, then it will become a mess and your developers won't be happy anymore. And actually, a goal that you should set for you as a tech lead, it would be to increase the developer happiness. Happier developer. You know, just a fun fact. In Silicon Valley, there is a local policy of keeping the population is in as much of an infant state as possible. Meaning, not adult. Why? Who is more creative? A stressed adult or a child? Stressed adult. Child has ideas, right? So you want happier, relaxed developers. Protect the developers, do magic to defend them. Do magic to reduce their effort and risk. Do stuff, exception handle stuff. Say stuff that will keep them safe and warm. Safe and warm. But don't write your own framework, for Christ's sake. Don't, avoid that. Avoid writing your own, the so-called CV-driven development. Don't do that. Don't do that to your developers. Avoid having them learn your bugs, your frameworks. Good. Then, fear kills creativity. World War has proven that. Yeah. So then, simplify unit testing. Make the test as smooth as possible. The Ocado guys in their bathrooms, toilets. They have Google Sheets about testing. Google Sheets about testing. Incredible stuff. So learn how to do testing properly.
On the toilet.
Next to the tail recursion in Scala. It's amazing. It's amazing. You know, tail recursion? Yeah. Building software. How do you... This is really how it feels? Do you build software like that? Do you build? The verb build is wrong. They should sue the guy who invented build. Probably make files or something old. Build. It's wrong. No. It is growing. Your software is not that. Your software is a garden. And you know that, right? You feel that. Your garden, it's a living organism which evolves in time. Your code base is not a construction. You don't lay out layer on top of layer of concrete. No. It just keeps growing. Oh my God. And every now and then, you need to take the mechanical saw, how they work, and adjust a bit the garden, right? This is how you should... Okay. So not the construction, but the garden metaphor. There is actually a movement, software gardeners, or starting from Greece, I think. People who call themselves software gardeners, right? Well, I'm not sure what employer will hire you, but the point is, it's an organic thing that you need to care about, right? Now, tell me, can you predict the future? Do you know what feature will become complex tomorrow?
I can predict failures.
You can predict failures. How many years of experience you have? How many decades? You can predict failures, so go ask him every now and then. But who of you can predict what feature will become super complex in time? What feature will grow wildly complex? You don't know that. You don't know that. So then, the point is to keep struggling for a simple design at all times. Keep it simple. Now, can you imagine a fight between a Teutonic Knight and a ninja? But pay attention. The Teutonic Knight is armed with design patterns. Can you see them? Look, just explain. The horse has this iron stuff because the enemy is usually in front. The spear is long, longer than the enemy's. But then, how many seconds do you think this fight will take? So the point is, don't do over-engineering. Don't defend your code with design patterns just because you think tomorrow they might be useful. Don't do that. Keep your code as supple, simple, flexible as possible, right? Keep your code simple. A simple architecture that is able to evolve to match the growing complexity. That's what this talk is actually about. There is data. Yes. There is... Her watch was talking to her. Oh my God. Wait. Entities are where you persist, are things that you store your persistent data, right? And the point about entities that we all tend to forget is that we control those entities. We should use those methods inside to simplify our logic as much as possible, right? So the point is to put super small, highly reusable bits of logic inside your domain entities. For example, just imagine, what does the get full name method do? Pair concatenation, what the heck, right? Little bits of logic, or maybe activate. This is actually more complex stuff. If you have an activate method on an entity, you might not have a set status method. Just realize, no more set status, but activate. What will activate do? It will check that the previous state was draft, right? This is actually what's called a state machine. You can implement checks in the method of your entities. No one thought of that, right? And one more thing, activated by, this doesn't need a setter anymore. You will set it all together when you activate the entity. Little state machine, little bits of logic, just place there in your entities. Or the beloved Boolean returning functions, which plays so nice with Java 8 filter, right? Super useful to have such methods in your entities. Or in case you are still on ORM, having the concern of linking both the bidirectional links, if you do that, try thinking again. Go to vladmihalja.com.
Yes.
Yes. Never mind. The point is, put a little bit of logic there and to grow, to have fit domain entities. Don't have bloated domain entities. That's the danger. The danger would be to put such a format in your entity. Just imagine that. So this is string format, %s, %s, what the heck is this? This garbage, my friend. This is a view concern. This is something that has nothing to do with your entity. You should not pollute your entity with such miserable code. Right? The point is highly reusable business logic bits that you can use everywhere to simplify the logic. But besides the entities, there is more. I forget to tell you, this will be super intense. Okay. Value objects are basically grouping of data that moves together. One example is, for example, money. Money has currency, has amount. Nice. Now, these to be healthy should be small and immutable, right? Small and immutable. Final fields, you know, just, but since they are immutable, why not validate the state wherever you instantiate such an object? So if it is created valid, it will remain valid for the remaining of its life. So why not? These are self-validatable objects. Now, compared to entities, value objects don't have IDs. That's fundamental. If you compare one money to another instance of money, you will compare them field by field, right? That's it. Maybe there are other languages around here, maybe case classes, okay? Data classes, I don't know. This kind of stuff, they are compared field by field. Very simple. Now, if you are an ORM, this can be safely added inside your entities using the embeddable stuff. Actually, all the persistent storages support that you take some field out of you and store it in a separate class. That's the point. Value objects. But then you expose data to your user interface. And they will start asking for an object to represent the results in this table. Customer name, last order date, region, response. These are things coming from five different entities. This has no meaning in your domain model whatsoever. It's just a projection for the user. Okay? But then just imagine this other field can be deleted. Just JSON, right? This is JSON. They ask for a field that can be deleted. Why do you think they need that field? Think.
GDPR.
What the heck? No. For the button, yes. If or not should display the button, okay? So, to know whether to put the button, they ask you for this field. Now, if you would expose your holy entities to them, just you, writing both, then your entity will be polluted with such concerns, which are from the view part of the story, right? So, the point is, the UI has different goals. They want data structure to match their screens. So you should never expose your entities in your API, given that you have some domain logic to defend. It's creepy, that's fine, but if you want, I will be here afterwards to discuss details. Now, so you will give them, instead of your entities, you will give them data transfer objects, which basically is a separate data model, which is just sent and received from the user interface, whatever that might be. It might be a swing, it might be a GSF, it might be a, I don't know, VSDL, JSON, whatever is there, different data sets. Now, these objects, by the way, this is called by an Italian guy, I don't remember the name. This was first called Light CQRS. It's a project, DDD calls it use case optimized queries. It's a projection only for the use of the user interface. It has no meaning in your entity model, thus should not be there. Should be there for your users. It's a light read model, light CQRF. Creepy, but interesting. But then, you know, this is the DTO, right? So you have a DTO, and like your mama told you, you will put private fields in public gets and susceptors, right? Wrong, this is not different than doing public fields. Oh my God, public fields. What the heck? I know what you're thinking. It goes like, I know what you're thinking. Sonar will complain, right? This is sonar? Sonar? You have sonar? Who has sonar? Sonar. Who goes beep, beep? Okay. That's matrix, okay? The victory of machines. Technically, public fields compared to public getters and setters compulsively created, it's not the difference, really. And I really prefer this form. Why? Because my data use should be as dumb as possible. As a side effect, look how nice this looks. Let me see. Remember C? Full name equals. 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 Oh, God. Now, so, what? At some point, there was Lombok mentioned, but I wouldn't argue. I don't know the team that you have here, but it's a dangerous weapon. I use it extensively, but it's a dangerous weapon. Now, organizing logic, to explain that, because you brought it up, Lombok is, unless you are super clear about the principles of programming, unless you know what OOP really means, don't do Lombok. So, logic, so you will have, what is this symbol? Do you remember? It was used 15 years ago I put the logo of UML. Yes, this is the logo of UML. Who knows UML? UML, yes. What does this stand for in UML? Do you remember? No, this symbol. Oh. An interface, thank you. So you expose interfaces to your user interface and you hope for the best. Good. But then this is the controller, right? And then under the controller, there is a service.
Always.
Of course, by default. And then probably you have a repository and some applications also have an infrastructure. We will see what gets there. Now, in the service layer, entities reign. It's their kingdom, right? Entities, the holy entities, right? Now, here in the controller, we will be manipulating JSON or other kind of UI data structures, which could have the can be deleted field, you know. Okay, then there will be data transferring, attacking your applications coming from other applications. Who here does domain-driven design? Raise your hand, domain-driven design. Interesting. Other bounded contexts, few of you. Okay, and in the repository, some teams take pleasure in creating a third the data model here. And all the day they are doing get, set. They are mapping from here to here. From here to here. 1% of the application do take an advantage from this. The other, no. So just persist those, be pragmatic. But then, with time, the first thing you need to do actually is to convert the entities into your DTO. So there is this transformation that needs to happen, right? When would you convert it? Would you convert it down here, or the first thing you do? Will you propagate the enemy data in your application? Or will you convert it to your data structures?
Well, yes,
it depends. But if you have, of course, but if you have business logic to defend, you wouldn't like to tolerate those objects for a long time. So the first thing you will do, you'll convert them, right? To your entities. Good, but there is also the validation concern and the transaction boundary concern. Where do transactions start? Should they start from here? Should they start from here? Should they start from here? I don't know. No, not here. But there is a decision today. The first thing, this layout works for 6, 9 months, 1 year of development. After which you will notice that the first sub-layer of service becomes different. Because it takes care of these concerns. At which point you say, rise facade. There you go. This is how the facade gets born. Because it's the first level of the service, right? Now, technically, each controller method is super tiny, one-liner, ideally. What the controller does is just calls down the facade. But the facade turns back and calls the service layer, right? Orchestrating the workflows. That's the point. It's an orchestrator. I don't see you wearing such costumes. Yeah, you know, okay, so we have data conversion to do. Where does it happen? Well, first thing, you need to do somewhere. One way to do this conversion is to do this kind of code. But I doubt that you got into programming to write such code. Right? So you like to hide it somewhere. So one way to put it is in the very constructor of your data transfer object. This is okay. It's okay for DTOs to depend on the holy entities, but not the other way around. No. But the miserable DTO can look up to the entity. It's okay. Just now, if the transformation is too complex, you will need to extract it somewhere, just to hide it somewhere. So you need some classes. The funniest name I ever heard is with transformers. They had transformer classes. Anyway, the point is you extract these things when they grow. What do you think of when you think of validation? We don't do it. Have you ever been pen tested? I will. Ouch! But validation. Validation. Some people are terrified by this concept. And I spent some trainings, one full day, 8 hours, talking just about validation. Freaking sick. One day.
This was the
pen test? No. With the training group. Just some quick points. There can be internal validation inside, based on only the fields of your object. External, that require queries in some external systems. Ubiquitous, the same for every use case. Or status specific, for example, in case there is a draft contract, it's okay to have a null name. Ouch. One quick word, if you are using not null, read about validation profiles. Validation profiles. Remember, validation profiles. Good. And then for if, then you will need auto. Anyway, the point is, you can do this on the data transfer object, on the entities, both, and many forms. A lot of things to discuss there. But then there is logic. And business will keep pouring logic on top of you. This is exactly how it feels, right? It just keep pouring features. I want this. And the first thing you okay. Where will this logic go to? Think. In there? Service. But no, I want you to resist the temptation and first try to push it in some entities. Now, some of you may recognize this book, the Big Blue Book. This is the closest thing to a horror book in computer science. I would never recommend reading it if you are not that first. Read for the primer, read the red book, the Vogt-Vernon book, way more accessible. And only then read the horror book. I had migraines after every 3 pages. I had to read it 3 times to understand it. It's absolutely hardcore stuff. So don't. That's what that guy here told us to do, to put as much logic in your entities and value objects. What?
Domain driven design.
Domain driven design. Thank you. Good. Thanks for asking. Good. But then there will be logic flowing. And in case the logic is not localized in one single object, then you will have to spend multiple entities and you will end up putting it in the service. But now you have another option to put it in the same. How to choose, right? This is actually a tough decision, even for domain-driven design practitioners. How to know what is domain-specific and how to know what is application-specific? What the heck is the difference? So, I will try to suggest a way to evolve an architecture based on this question, really. What I will do is super simple. I have done that for 7 applications. What I will do is simple. I will start writing all the domain logic in the facade. In the facade. Everything there. Some use cases will be 3 lines long. Just imagine, get user by ID. How many lines do you think this method will have? 3? Short, right? If it's short, it remains implemented entirely in the facade. If it's big enough, imagine the place order. How big would place order be? Then what would you do? You would extract that to a domain service, right? Because it's so complex, then you extract it again because it's still too complex. keep extracting stuff while keeping the classes small enough. We'll see what that means. Now, what if you want to do some shared logic between these two facades? Will you copy-paste code? I hope not. Do you know how this technique is referred to? Copy-paste programming. So the point is here, you will basically create a domain service not to repeat yourself in depend both places in that class, and again, right? To reduce duplication. But have you noticed the colors? The colors. Did you know that 20 times more people, more men, suffer by dyschromatopsy? It's a various degrees of color perceiving problems. 20 times more than women. Yes. So, men, do you see this is reddish, orangish, and this is yellow, the color of joy, happiness. The same color of the entities, the color matter, the domain services that you extracted speak your domain model. That's key, folks. When something is complex enough, it gets extracted into a separate object, into a domain service, and the domain service will speak your whole sacred domain model. Now, DPOs are fragile because they might change without notice. You wouldn't like to start building complex logic on data structures you do not control. So, that's why I like my DPOs not to have any methods. You know why? Because any method there will look suspicious. What with that method? Well, if there are dozens of getters and setters, one more method is no problem, right? But if there is no method, you will feel awkward. What the hell? Why am I putting this method here? And that's exactly how I want you to feel. I don't want any logic created on my DTOs. I want it on my entity model that I control. So keep the DTOs out of your system. Convert them as soon as you get them into your entities. Make sense? Right? Transform and then work with your objects that you control, that you can enrich with bits of logic. So what does a facade do, really? As a summary, so the facade will is the first thing that that sees the data transfer object. So we need to do the conversion. If the conversion is complex enough, it will get extracted. If and only if it is complex, the facade will also implement business logic. But if the business logic is simple, let it be there, no problem. If it's too complex, it gets extracted into domain service and again extracted. The facade is the first thing that sees the enemy data structure. Have you heard of the guiltiness presumption? So we have to validate the data. The guiltiness presumption. So the first thing you do, validate the data. If it's simple or use annotation, it finishes in several lines. If not, extract the validator. That's it. Now, I will impose the additional rule that a facade is not allowed to call each other to another facade. Right? This is not allowed in my architectures. And then, what does this give me? If you have ever heard of proxies from Spring, hatshoo! How many of you are working on Spring? Oh, Spring. Okay, one term, interesting. So, yeah, the point is, if you weave aspects in front of your facade, then you get, by default, a place that you can intercept calls and do things just once per use case, like transaction management, transaction requires view, for example, or logging, or, I don't know, exception handler, access control, although REST controller advice is way better, of course. But the point is everywhere. You see, I extract. This is the point. This is the exact point. Extract when it grows. What the heck does that mean? Well, when something is bigger than 200 lines of code, oh my god. Wait. I can't believe my eyes at this one. Is it 200? Or 20,000? No, 200. When something is bigger than 200, you should extract. Actually get a mail if a class exceeds 200. Don't tell them. But the point is, what do I mean? Well, you created a class, and you name it product service. It had 20 lines. It had 20 lines. You created with your own hands. It is like your baby. 20 lines. Then other developers came and put more features because it's product service. You can put anything in the product service. And after several months, you find it like this. I mean, I'm not sure if you can. What does it look like? Have you ever photocopied your...
What is it like?
The thing is, you don't recognize the class. Who are you? You are product. I made you. Who are you now? So it's weird for you. So that, the point is, when this happens, you will try to sniff around and see what the heck is this class doing, and try to find a name to represent some of its methods. You seek a good name. When you find a good name,
manager.
Next to util. You saw the picture, don't you? Okay, so you extract. Whenever you find a good name, you extract. Simple enough. Same piece of cake, right? Piece of cake. But do you know this famous code? There are only two things hard in programming. Cache invalidation. And naming things.
And
not by one. But this is hacking around. No, the real stuff is this. Naming things. And so there are conferences out there who just... I have a problem here. How do I get Windows Escape? There you go. There are conferences where people gather and decide how to name things. It's incredible. People go, yeah, the domain driven. Sorry. And the what? JCP? JCP! Oh god. No, what happens really here is that when you sniff around, you are literally looking for another responsibility in the class that you created. And it's very hard because you are emotionally bound to your own child. You just created it several months ago. And then suddenly, we have to cut it in two. What kind of a parent? Okay. So it's hard, it's emotionally hard. Because, but this is the flavor of SRP that I want to apply. To apply SRP when there is enough garbage. Right? Not to generate 10 lines of classes. Actually, Dimitri answered me once on Twitter, asking me, what do I think about premature refactoring? Premature refactoring. His question. I was like, I fall off my chair. What? And then I thought, wait, he's right. Wait a second. Premature refactoring. Don't make classes 10 lines long. Wait for garbage to pile up. Maybe not that big. Maybe it's that big. Okay? And when it's enough, just enough garbage, the concept of just enough garbage, jik, just enough garbage, jik, yes, I brought it, okay. Just enough garbage, then you clean up stuff, right? Now, this is what I mean. If you have a customer food state which is growing long, you will start sniffing around. And you might see that save customer, get customer, search customer has to do with the customer. Well, save customer preferences, get customer quick check. How is my audio? Is it okay there? Okay, I'm not sure about it. Save customer preferences, get customer preferences, all of this stuff belong to the preferences of the customer. So what could you do? You could break it into two classes, right? Horizontally splitting it in two. What the hell do I mean by horizontal splitting? Oh my god, horizontal, really? Meaning the class that you extract is on the same level of abstraction to the original class. What? Level of abstraction. Level of abstraction. He's insane. What the hell? What that really? Abstract in English can't be even, you can't say more abstract. It's incorrect grammatically. But still, these two are siblings. The one who called the former now calls the new one. Very simple. But if there is horizontal extraction, would there be vertical extraction? Oh shit. Okay, so order service, delivery service, you have two services who want to send an email. Okay? You could couple them together, but maybe even better would be to extract an alert service and depend on that from both places. Right? An email service that sends the email. Okay, so for not repeating yourself. But then think of the order service. What if there is this composite order, super complex? What could you do? You could take some of the logic out into a composite order service. Technically, just a bit of the feature is there in another class to keep things simple. And this, my friend, is called vertical extraction because what you extracted down is on a lower level of abstraction. It is more detailed work. It's like this is... The officer, this is the general, right? This is the grunt, this is the general. It's high level, low level, okay? Now, this is not easy, especially this kind of refactoring. Especially if you have loads of tests on it. There's a decision there, whether to put a mock in between or not. My answer is no. Don't. Okay. Who of you does unit tests? Those of you who don't out. You do what?
I asked Biden to stop lying.
Practice. Takes lots of practice to do that. Coding cattle, hackathons, mob refactoring, but moreover than anything else, pair programming, like in life. Pair. Deep. Now, why do I love and do pair programming? Wait a second, see if I can hold the microphone. But why do I do and love doing pair programming? Fun, clearly. Times more fun. Better design, of course. While you are digging the ditch, right? Bianca, my usual pair, just sits there and say, oh, Victor, wait a second, what you doing? She has, while I'm doing this, she stares at it. Thinking, you know? That's what, better design. Less bugs, proven, 15% less bugs, c2.com. More passion, of course. You writing code. You with someone else next to you. I measure myself, I type 3 times faster when someone is watching. 3 freaking times faster. Natural language though, if I call you up to teach you something, come here to teach you something, would you come?
How much?
How much? How much beer do you give me if you come? No, but if I call you for help, if I call you to help me, prepare with me, you will come. And I could send you some hints, like I will after during the live demo. You will see me using IntelliJ. IntelliJ. And then increases code reuse. You would know what Bianca did, and Bianca would know what I did, right? Team bonding. What team building if you've been spending 6 hours per day pairing with everyone? Easier code reviews. What code reviews? I know all the code. We actually have, if you don't believe me, I want to prove it to you. We actually have a literal pig. And I will pass the microphone to the pig. It took me months to do that, but people now, I've convinced them to squeeze the pig whenever they have a problem in code that's just 1% above their comfort zone. And now, if they still have a problem, they squeeze the pig again. Another developer will come to them. So, but realize the sound, look. It is a profound, safe sound. Still funny, very deep, reassuring. I searched for it, I got dozens of these things, and I give them as prizes to my trainers. But the point is, ask for help, right? Ask for help. And then, this is what your boss could be interested in. It's cheaper on the long run. That's the link. Interesting. For some most projects, they would just go there. Now, the point is, again, is to have comfortable developers. Now, how do you feel when you read, let's read, I'm an architect to save time, let's just assume I'm always right. Now, tell me, what's wrong with this t-shirt?
It's yellow.
It's not? It's not wrong, eh? What's wrong? Come on, how many of you? 100. What's wrong with this t-shirt? Think.
Grammar.
It's missing an N. But it took you several seconds. Why? Because the rest of you, your brain just closed, right? A defense mechanism. Look what an asshole. And your brain shuts down. So, it's safe. It's safer. Good. Now, the point is here, sorry for this, I will clean it up. The point is, this guy has an antisocial attitude. What should you do? And by the way, do you know what this is, my friends? It's rarely seen, but it's an ivory tower. Now, You should get to the nearest gas station. E equals mc squared. Light, my friends. And enlightenment. This is a junior architect, formerly junior JavaScript developer. Left line of code 10 plus years ago. And guess why he's missing the head? Okay, so in this happy town, let's talk about the most advanced architecture in the world, the onion architecture. They keep reinventing it every 5 or 7 years. They initially call it hexagonal, then ports and adapters, then the onion, and then they keep rebranding it. It's the same shit. So, if you want to protect some code, you will put it in the holy domain module, in the fortress, inside your fortress. The domain services go there, which are your jewelry. The kings go there, and princes. The domain objects. Okay, so this is the domain in which there is the precious code that you want to protect. In front of the domain, of course, is the user. So we will build a defense in front of the user. There we go, better. You will defend yourself against, but by putting this in an application Maven module, you will have this module depending on the domain. But if you look careful enough at this code, will a DTO here be able to be visible in the domain? Will you see the DTO from the domain? If you press, as you always do, control space. How many of you are pressing control space when writing emails? Seniors, huh? It doesn't work for a sec. Although Google started implementing it recently. It's awful, yeah. So basically, this dependency means that anything from here is not visible there, which is good. The dirt stays out. The DTOs are kept out. Can't possibly enter your domain if you look careful. I will share the presentation with you. We will see in the background. So what if in your domain service will want to call some external service? If you call an external service, it will come together with some set of data structures, evil data structures. If you call that guy from your code, then you let your enemy inside your fortress, which is bad. So what could you do? Well, in front of your external service, you will want to take that out of your domain. This is where the Zen garden is. But then there is where the infrastructure lies. Just to be clear, you will be writing code in both places, but wearing gloves or dining in the living room. It's you, it's a different mindset. Now, in the infrastructure, you will handle that external service by placing an adapter in front of it. Now, from the domain, you will call the adapter, which will call them further, doing the transformation, the validation, what's necessary when you talk to a foreign API. Good, now, if the dependencies are like that, your domain needs to depend on infrastructure, right?
True.
So then, anything from there can slip inside, which is bad. But then look what I did, I peeled the class. What do you get when you peel a class? When you peel a class, what do you get?
Importance.
A what?
Port.
An interface. So you will name it very wisely, I adapter. Okay, so then, in the implementation, you will implement that. To be able to see the class, you will need to have the dependency this way. But let's spend a minute watching how joyful this arrow is. Do you feel the joy in that arrow? Let me turn back time a bit. I'm going back in time. What the heck happened? The dependence just reverted when I dragged the interface inside of the domain. Can you see? Then, this is actually called... But the point is, this is the domain. Let's put it in words. When from your domain wants to call some external thing, you will first express your desire in an interface, speaking your own friendly, holy, sacred entity model. And then you put your gloves, you go there, and you start implementing the contract by working with the evil data structures and API, right? Serving your domain. It's you both places, but you are serving the domain, really. It's a mental segregation. Now, the direction of the call goes like this. At runtime, domain will call the implementation, but at the compilation time, the dependency is inverted. This is why this is called dependency inversion principle. inversion, not injection, although it relies on injection usually, is inversion. Meaning, abstraction should not depend on details. This holy higher level policy should not depend on miserable stuff like, I don't know, are you exception? Or I don't know, some external system. Now, dependency inversion, because these two go against each other. This makes possible that nothing from the infrastructure can ever enter again the domain. If you carefully look at the dependency direction, if you are here and you press control space, you won't see the DTOs from the enemy because they are not there. The dependency doesn't work like that, right? Uncle Bob says this is the best thing OOP gives us. I don't necessarily believe that, but it's still something you want to try whenever you, from the domain, you want to originate an interaction with the four existing integration paradigms. Synchronous calls, asynchronous messaging, deep link, or file transfers. Whenever you want to isolate yourself from the evil enemy data structures, okay? That's what you could use. The end goal is to be able to reason about your application without being concerned of the infrastructural miseries of another system. To be able to focus on your domain logic. Okay, so we have the domain. We have interfaces from external systems, from repositories if you don't use GPA, the application in front of it, some infrastructure module behind it, some repo if you're doing some miserable stuff there, maybe some batch stuff. But notice all of these domain, Maven modules depend on the domain, right? You look at the red arrows. What this buys us is that the domain remains agnostic. I don't want to defend myself from Springer, Hibernate, like in my case. Don't defend yourself from framers, not if they are mature enough. But defend from other data models, from other concerns. It's deep, this thing. This, my friend, is called the onion architecture. That's it. The middle, the center of an onion is sweeter. Yes, you know that, right? What makes you cry are the outer layers. Deep. Okay, now, I'm a pragmatic guy and too many modules for me. So what do I do? Again, I have enemies in front of me, enemies behind me, and sometimes enemies below me. Set null. Update customer set name equal null, equals null. Okay, so because I'm a pragmatic guy, I will merge all these in one single module, and I will call this domain equals Zen and garbage equals application. This I call it the pragmatic onion. I've done several applications this style. It works for even large applications. The largest one has 3 years of development for 5 people, but until now we just considered breaking it into the classic style. It doesn't give us anything. And if you do that, there is one interesting catch. This is the first time I'm saying this in talks. If you have a use case going here, you could bypass the domain and go with the repository in the database. Remember the light CQRS? Remember the results? For those of you on Hibernate, select new from in GPQL, okay? The point is whenever you want, you can bypass and walk the unsafe neighborhood until you get where you need to go. But there is no logic in there, just a query, right? So why go into the domain? Pragmatic onion. Now, naming. Would you call a baby util one? No. Sorry?
Mistake one.
Helper one. Mistake. Oh, come on! I have lots of friends in computer. You know how they, what's commonly referred to as the first child, is the child proof of concept. if it works, you need the second one, right? Yeah. Good. Yeah. I'm not kidding here. So. Package names, about naming, right? How would you name your package? So if com, my organization, my app, and then comes the fun part. What's next?
Helpers.
Helpers. For say you maybe some of you recognize these packages. But then this is fine for 1, maybe 2 years, I don't know. At some point you realize that for grew too much. And the services grew too much. And what do? You split them. After several weeks, months, you split the entities too, because they have too many classes. You have to scroll to see the whole package, you know? And you keep splitting. At some point you think, what the heck are you doing? This case is order, order, order. So then what do? It's simple. And Uncle Bob calls it the clean architecture technology, because the top level package structure reflects the internal domain, not some technically boring layering. So you will crack it and you will break it. And then we will have, actually, you will have the two little onions. Two little onions. Tell me, if you split it in two, it's in the same code base, same Git repository, same everything. Modularizing the monolith. Tell me, if you split it in two, would you like, I recommend you check out Axel Fontaine's talk on Majestic Monolith. It's a scale that you can go until the micro So you start from a monolith and you modularize it. And you can stop anytime you want. There is a scale. You don't need to go all the way there. There is a scale. Very interesting talk. Super deep. Go check it out. But two onions. Would you like to have an entity here depending on another entity here? No. Would you like to call from the domain service here, a domain service here, there? Yeah. No, never. And then this, you should go, and have you ever seen a monkey scratching their head like this?
I saw
people do that. Woohoo! Okay, so, why? Because you hope. You hope. You hope. See what you hope in a second. Then, transactions. Will you have transactions spanning two onions? No, because you hope. But at the moment you sacrifice transactionality constraints, you start having nightmares. You don't know why exactly the first time. Just wake up in the middle of the night, 3 a.m. You don't know why, you know? And you will end up maybe using events to pass between them to have two separate transactions. Two separate transactions. And one of them will fail, the other no. Okay. But then there will be two database schema. Right? Tell me, would you like to have a foreign key between these two schemas? But again, you because you know what will happen, right? You will have a dangling foreign key, which is, what do you call it? Like, I don't know the term. Points nowhere. Russia. So basically, points nowhere. Now, you will do what? You will replicate. Why? Because there are use cases out there which require queries from multiple places, from both sub-schemas, right? So you will do queries spanning both of them. This will translate in the macro world into an, I don't know, Lucene, something like indexing engine, Elasticsearch, a separate application anyway. So these are querying the two schemas is still okay. When you will break it into micro tree, then this will certificate in a separate application. But you sacrificed a lot. You sacrificed links between GPL entities. You sacrificed calls and went like this. You kill transactions, you kill foreign keys, you replicate the data for performance issues. My God, all the many things that you do. And in the end, you will cut them.
It doesn't even matter?
Technically, you could stop at any point. Go check out this talk. I did this slide and then I listened to this, like, and I go, whoa, exactly. At every 5 minutes, exactly. And I'm like, and it doesn't matter. Okay. In the end, you will hope that you could There's a book we're currently under publishing from Tom Newman. He's to be blamed for, partially, for Microsh. Very interesting book. I stopped reading it. It's not yet published, but it is already available on O'Reilly Learning. Hey, have you heard of Arc Unit? Oh, cool. Rule equals classes that reside in a package which service in their name should only be accessed by any package named controller or service. Ooh, guess what? In case you break the rule, the unit test will fail. This is GUnit, folks. Integrated with GUnit. Just checks dependencies. It also provides you a set of deviations, and you can measure how far you are from where you want to get. I will share with you all the slides if you share with me your email during break. That's why I'm just, I know you, but I will give you all the slides anyway. Jenkins. Okay, sorry, you can remember, it's your garden, your God, no one will care where you live. It's you that is supposed to keep it clean. But do you know what this is? Water bear, exactly. It is the most resilient organism on Earth. It can almost resist an atomic bomb. It can live 5 minutes in outer space. It can survive hundreds and hundreds of years. I can't imagine what this guy has been through. But the conclusion is that you need constraints for evolution to happen. Otherwise, why do you think the northern countries are more developed than us? Because if they didn't took care of everything, they would die during winter. Simple as that. So then, you need a fitness function. You would need, I mean, historically, anthropological, let's say. The fitness function needs to be there to guide your evolution towards where it must be. Well, source 5 science is one of my favorite fitness functions. But there are others, read the book, in which, like, measuring how far you are from a scalable. These are actually harder to implement on a pipeline, on Jenkins. But this is quite easy to do, right? Measuring how big your file is. I don't like 10 lines of code classes. I don't like 200 or 500 lines of classes. Books, lots of books. And that's it, I think. Yes, let me see the agenda. Agenda, what we've covered. What did we learn? KISS, keep it simple. Keep it simple, avoid over-engineering. Avoid over-engineering at all costs. Or premature optimization. Or premature refactoring. Magic, do magic to protect your developers. Do magic to protect, but I want to repeat that. Be strong, be courageous, let the garbage pile up. Just enough garbage. More than there is enemy data out there. There are DTOs that you don't control, don't trust them. Convert them, but this is one point I should repeat. If your application is a boundary system, just converting data, being in itself a huge adapter, you don't have a domain, I'm sorry to say, but that application doesn't have a brain. Such an application doesn't care about enemy data. Logic, there will be the extracting, continuous extraction. If you don't do that, you will degenerate into 2,000 lines of code classes, manager classes. Then, the onion, dependency inversion, that's the point here, deep. It is the D in the solid principles, the D. The higher level policy should not depend on lower level details. Test and fear is easy. We test, let them smash your design. Let them smash your design. Let them give you honest feedback about how bad your design is. And if I would summarize it in one word, keep it simple. What's next for you? The fastest way to learn is to teach the others. The fastest way to grow into a senior is to help the others grow. And I like this venue here, so I like the stuff that you gather regularly and explaining and teaching and sharing back. That's the fastest way to grow, trust me. That's why I got into this training stuff. I wanted to learn more, and there's no better way than teaching the others. No better way. And in another thing, put passion in everything that you do. I'll be here afterwards. But what's next for you? A lot of stuff here. I have stickers. Yes, I have stickers. But I will give you after everything. If you stay up later with me, what really next for you now is that you need to vote. To vote. I'm not sure if you can scan this QR directly. I hope you can. If not, does it work? Yeah, cool. Now, it should get you to a Google form. Did it?
Yeah.
Good. And there are three options there, right? Three?
No, it says it's no longer accepting.
Yeah. One second. No issue. Retry.
Can I have the code?
Sure. Cool. Nice. Did it work now? Does it work? Three options. You should see three options. Is it so? Probably the title is wrong. I forgot to update it. But do you see three options? Can someone please show me what you see? Perfect. That's it. So now, the plan is the following. You have 5 minutes to vote. At 8:25, we will continue with a quick live coding session. After which, after that, there will be the beer and stuff. But so, vote now, and in five minutes we will come back and see the results. Okay?
Yeah.
Good. Now, in case anyone of you has to leave at any point during that half an hour, just feel free to leave anytime you want. Good. Thank you. 5 minutes break. Should I give you the stickers now?
How comes the fun part?
If you want, I could give you the stickers now. What?
No? No.
If
you give the stickers, they will go away.
No, I won't give the stickers. Just to see the stickers.